gloria di colui che tutto muove, per l'universo penetra e risplende in una parte più e meno altrove. Nel ciel che più della sua luce prende, fui.
The glory of him who moves everything shines throughout the universe, but sometimes more in one region and less in another. I have been in the heaven which receives more of his light than anywhere else. It was in the year of our Lord 1300, and I, Dante Alighieri, was 35 and about to complete the last part of my journey into paradise.
It was midday, and I was standing by my Lady Beatrice's side on the top of Mount Purgatory. She turned and lifted her eyes towards the sun and stared at it steadily. I allowed myself to follow her gaze. I was able to look into the sun longer than I could have done on Earth, but then it became lighter and lighter, as if full daylight had been added to full daylight and a second sun had been put in the sky.
Lady Beatrice, I...
Say what you want to say.
Just now my eyes were dazzled, but I...
But you could look into the light longer than you expected.
Yes.
You have drunk of the waters of Lethe, and you have forgotten your past sins. You have drunk of the waters of Aunoe, and recalled every time in your life when you have done good. That is why your sight is becoming stronger.
I've seen hell. I've seen purgatory. I still can't believe that I'm about to visit paradise.
You needed spiritual help, and through me it has been granted to you.
I still keep asking myself, is there presumption in what I have made in my poem of my first love? A beautiful woman I only loved from afar, who died very young. I have to remind myself that it was through my feelings for her that I first began to understand there might be something transcendental in human love. A hint of a higher meaning to my life. No, the real presumption is trying to describe paradise.
Forgive my ignorance, but, what happens now?
We leave the mountaintop and ascend through the nine circles of heaven.
And then?
Beyond are things you cannot hope yet to comprehend. Beyond lies the Empyrean, the highest and purest heaven, closest to God himself.
My mind struggles to grasp this.
Any human being's mind would struggle, because it is beyond humanity's conception.
I don't even know how we can begin our ascent.
We are carried there by the principle which rules the universe. We surrender ourselves to the natural order and leave behind all the doubts and fears and frailties that stop mankind from achieving what it could. Shall we go?
La concreata e perpetua sette del deiforme regno ci importava, veloci, quasi come il ciel vedette.
The innate and unending thirst for that kingdom which is created in God's image bore us swiftly upwards. It was as if you only had to look up into the sky and you were in motion. Beatrice gazed upwards, and I gazed on her.
We reached up towards the sphere of the moon, the first sphere of the heavens.
Lady!
What is it?
Just a small question.
Ask it.
The moon. It should be perfect, shouldn't it? But it has dark spots on it, visible to even those down there on Earth. God can create perfection, so... Why the spots?
That is a good question. But it is not a small question. It is a question about the whole of God's universe and why there is imperfection. Why didn't God just create a universe uniformly and glowingly perfect?
Forgive me, but...
But what?
I'm providing an answer to my own question.
And what is that answer?
God must delight in diversity. There's nothing uniform about the world that God has created for us. Am I being foolish?
You are becoming less foolish with every moment.
I look around me, and I think I see human faces. They must be reflections of something. They can't be real.
You take them for illusions, and these are probably the most real existences you have ever seen. In this first sphere, the sphere of the moon, are those who made their holy vows but failed to fulfill them.
So, there is a hierarchy even here in Paradise.
Of course. Everything is a series of steps, even here. Although you will not hear the shrieks of hell or the agonized cries of those who tried to rise higher in purgatory. Did you think there were shortcuts to enlightenment?
Again, you make me feel very stupid.
No, you are open to understanding. Here you can speak with those who aim so high with their vows, but fail to achieve what they had promised. Look, you see that spirit there? She wants to speak to you.
I am Piccarda Donati.
You're here, Piccarda. My wife's cousin.
Yes, it's me, and I am blessed to be here. Although I am placed in the lowest of the spheres because I failed to live up to the high ideals I had.
But, Piccarda, from what I know, what happened was not your fault.
The facts are still these. Mine was one of the proudest and most powerful families in all of Florence, but I was always drawn to the spiritual life, and very early I joined the convent of St. Clair. I renounced all material wealth, took vows of chastity, and devoted myself to good works. That is how I would have wished to remain. But it was not to be. My brother Corso still lived very much in the material world, and he wanted to use me to strengthen an alliance with the Tozer family. And so he dragged me out of the convent and forced me to marry Rossellino della Tozer. He was not a bad man, but there was no love between us, and I betrayed the vows of chastity I had made.
Then I was right. It wasn't your fault.
I still betrayed my vows.
Don't you yearn to be higher up?
The virtue of love calms our desires.
I believe you.
To want more would not be in accordance with God's will. In God's will is our peace.
To accept what has happened to us has happened. And there is no going back is a valuable quality to have. There are times when I've managed to achieve that acceptance. And, of course, times when I have failed miserably. I'm living in Ravenna, where I'm respected, given the support I need to finish my work. But, oh, how I long to see my native Florence once more, and walk by the banks of the Arno. After all, the political squabbles that caused my banishment are long in the past, and what they were about long forgotten. And I am, after all, the poet Dante, and a famous son of Florence. Maybe I will still be allowed to return.
Has she not been punished more than she deserved?
Why do you say that?
Because she was forced to do what she did.
And what did she do when that physical force which carried her off was removed?
When her husband died, you mean?
When she had a choice, she did not go back to the convent.
But there could be all sorts of reasons for that.
She did not go back.
And she had a choice.
God gave us all free will. The punishments you have seen in hell, the struggling towards something better you have seen in purgatory, none of this makes any sense if God has simply decided. And mankind has no say in the matter.
But there are circumstances in which...
Of course, circumstances do define us. Piccarda Donati came from a rich and powerful family, and they forced her to do something she did not want to do. But she still had a choice.
She could have killed herself.
You know how God judges those who do that.
Yes, I have seen the suicides down in hell. Ghastly skeletal trees with bleeding branches. So we are confined by our circumstances, but we are still free to make choices.
We rise now to another level, the second heaven, ruled by Mercury.
And what spirits do we meet here?
Spirits moved by love of glory.
Tyrants? Dictators? Surely they can't be here.
Not all love of glory is sinister and destructive. Sometimes it can represent a genuine wish to achieve something worthwhile.
From my knowledge of the politics of Florence, I think I need persuading on that issue.
Then listen to the Emperor Justinian.
The world has not always thought well of me, nor written well of me, or my wife, who first brought me to Christ. But God has judged me more kindly than the world, and given me a place here among those who loved him truly. Although the truth is that my ambition often led me from the true path. Still, it was God inspired me to codify Roman law out of a jumble of small, confused, and sometimes contradictory laws into a single, coherent, consistent system. To make sense out of incoherence is to further God's vision on earth.
We are still grateful for what you did and the guidance it gave. All over Italy, the Justinian Code is still in use.
That is a tribute to God, not to me. But there is more. I rule over an empire which, whatever its faults, was inspired by a vision of unity. An empire in which the notion of self-sacrifice for the common good still existed. And when I look at Italy today, I despair. Faction fights faction endlessly for personal gain. Indeed, sometimes it seems only from personal vindictiveness, the wish to see somebody humiliated and apparently less happy than you are yourself. Not even Italy's religious leaders rise above these petty squabbles. They too have lost any sense of a higher purpose. I was not always a good man, believe me. I was certainly not a perfect man, because no one is. But for all the corrupting compromises and questions of self-interest solved in the wrong way, somewhere inside me there was a vision.
You glow with an inner light.
I cannot see that, but I feel it.
Does ambition ever strike you now? Do you ever wish that you were higher up in the circles of paradise?
Not once have I felt that. My ambition is gone. I am filled with gratitude to be where I am.
The same answer as Piccarda.
What is your thought?
She told me that to want more would not be in accordance with God's will. In God's will is our peace. Justinian said much the same.
Acceptance of our lot is part of the journey into paradise. That and love.
Love?
That is the key. God's love reveals itself without conditions, and whatever it creates without intermediary is immortal, free, and godlike. But man has sinned, and can only be reinstated by a free pardon.
And only those who can recognize and accept God's love can benefit from it.
You're beginning to understand.
Io non m'accorsi del salire in ella, ma d'esservi entro mi fe assai fede la donna mia chi vidi far più bella.
I had no sense of rising with my lady into the third heaven, but I was reassured that I really was there because I could see her growing still more beautiful.
Then I saw torches lit and spirits moving in a cosmic dance.
These spirits are those whose love of God was sometimes diverted to the love of fellow man or fellow woman.
Is that a reproach to me?
We are in the sphere of Venus, but love is both sensual and spiritual. The spirits here loved the sensual, but never lost sight of the spiritual.
As I did.
They want to speak to you. Talk to them.
That woman
Looks as if she recognizes me.
Do you recognize her?
I believe I do.
I am Kunitsa Romano. I know that I was something of a standing joke in Florence because of my love life. There were the affairs with a succession of glamorous young men, including the poet Sordello, which continued after the men and I myself were no longer young or glamorous. And there were my four husbands. Gossip would say that I wore them out, but that's just the sort of thing that gossip always says. I welcomed them into my bed as I welcomed my lovers into my bed, and I enjoyed what happened between us.
So you feel no remorse?
There is no place in paradise for remorse or regret. That is why it is paradise.
You died, I recall, in your 80s, after what can only be described as a very full life.
My star is Venus, and I lived under its influence. But I humbly and joyfully accept that I have a predisposition to love. At the end of my full life, as you call it, my inclination turned from carnal lust towards fervent love of God. I'd always known the two were linked, and so I found my true way in the end, for which I am eternally blessed.
In hell, I showed Francesca da Rimini perpetually blown by whirlwinds. She and her lover Paolo locked forever in a purely physical, sensual embrace. But now I show how Kunitsa has found her way out of the cycle of lust. Is that just?
And so we rise into the fourth sphere.
What spirits live there?
The spirits of the wise. Theologians, philosophers, scholars.
And what sign rules there?
The sun. Give thanks to him who shines on all the angels, who by his grace has elevated you to the region of the living sun.
I cannot find the words to convey what I saw. But then human imagination cannot grasp such heights. No wonder, because no human eye has ever seen beyond the sun. In the brightness, I began to make out figures who glowed with an inner brilliance all of their own. A group of them circled us as if they were a crown above our heads. Suddenly, I had some foretaste of the spiritual journey that lay ahead of me.
True love has been lit there. Its light will lead you upward by that stairway which none descends except to climb again. He who has once experienced heavenly bliss will always return to it, and every spirit will gladly love him who has been so blessed.
A second circle of light enclosed the first like a glorious double rainbow. A voice spoke. And somehow I knew immediately where to look to identify the speaker. And the rest stood still, like candles in a candlestick. The speaker had read the doubts which had suddenly flashed through my brain.
We are above the world now, but we are men of thought, and we know that many things trouble living souls like yourself. If mankind is capable of moving towards spiritual wholeness, why on earth are ideals so often betrayed? Here, among the blessed, resides St. Francis of Assisi. He abandoned a privileged existence for a life of poverty. He took to heart what Christ said in the Gospels about spreading the word of God without any thought for material comfort. Clad in a rough garment, barefoot, without even a walking stick, he preached repentance. When others joined him, he insisted that absolute poverty was essential to all members of his order. He believed that nature itself was the mirror of God, and he called all of God's creatures his brothers and sisters, bird, fish, or beast. If ever a man led a human life which foreshadowed the divine, it was St. Francis. And look at the Franciscan order today. That was your thought, wasn't it?
They are greedy, corrupt, and only concerned for their own personal status.
They bicker among themselves about who is the true inheritor of the legacy of St. Francis. Just because one man has made a remarkable spiritual journey does not mean that his followers don't need to make spiritual journeys of their own, and few of them care enough to do that.
I am all too aware that fallible mortals can only take paradise in small doses. I'm like that too. Part of me yearns towards transcendence and is filled with wonderful visions. Part of me is still vexed by the corruption and injustice of the world I still live in. But then, as I said, no human eye has ever seen beyond the sun.
Imagine 24 of the brightest stars of the sky. Imagine them then forming two concentric circles. How else can I convey what I saw?
They sing now of the three persons in one nature of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the two natures, human and divine, in the person of Christ. We rise now to the fifth heaven, which is ruled by Mars.
Then this must be the place where the courageous dwell, where the lust for war is turned into something which is powerful for good. Do I read your thoughts, or do you read mine?
The distinction is already becoming unimportant.
Only because of you.
So you still cannot look fully into my eyes?
I'm still not ready. How odd that the only time I ever looked you in the eyes fully was when I first saw you, lovely and alive, in the streets of Florence.
Hush. We are in paradise.
Oh, forgive me.
If I hadn't forgiven you, would I be taking you on this journey?
In the midst of the red glowing light, a cross gleamed white. Souls in light moved and passed around the cross, singing songs of victory. And then suddenly, silence.
Dante? Dante Alighieri.
Who are you?
I am Cacciaguida, your great-great-grandfather. The father of the Alighiero from whom your name is derived.
You were a brave warrior, I remember. You fought in the Crusades?
In the Crusades, when the Crusades were genuinely dedicated to a higher purpose, not used as an excuse for pillage and destruction. I was born in Florence, long, long before you, when it was a walled city confined within its walls, and its citizens lived simple and peaceful lives. There I was also baptized, and there I married. And then, more than 100 years before you were born, I followed the Emperor Conrad on his holy crusade. He knighted me, and I fought valiantly for the Christian cause. I was killed in battle, but I was allowed to arise here, to the peace of heaven.
I am honored that you wish to speak to me. You are the most revered of all my ancestors.
But what?
I somehow feel that pride in my noble ancestry is a very trivial thing to be remembering here, in the highest heaven.
Of course, that is true. But I see things that you need to see in order to make peace with yourself.
You're thinking of Florence?
Florence is always in your mind.
So tell me.
My thoughts on Florence as it is now.
You read my mind.
I am part of your mind.
So tell me.
You ask me what I think about Florence. Let's not be sentimental about the old Florence, the Florence that I lived in. Of course there were quarrels, of course there was discontent, but it was under control and could be talked about. The Florence of today is a crazy, greedy city. Its women have become whores. Its men live only to fight each other for material gain. If one faction is expelled from the city, then the remaining faction very soon afterwards splits and starts fighting among itself. It's like the legendary Hydra. Cut off one faction and the remaining faction divides into two almost as soon as the first split takes place. That's even true among the Florentine exiles, isn't it?
Yes. I admit it.
A few years ago, I recall, when I was 50 and the city of Florence was in danger, the ruling party made a list of those in the opposing party who would be allowed back into the city.
Every previous amnesty, my name never featured. But this time it did. No longer would I be burned to death if I set foot within the city walls. Maybe this was because I was in the process of becoming a famous poet. Maybe it was because I was too old to be a real threat. I got word that I might be allowed to return home. Yes, home. For all its faults, that was what it was.
When you were first thrown out, you shared a common cause. And then suddenly you're calling each other names. Your fellow exiles turned on you, didn't they?
Yes, but they turned on each other too. It all became very mad and very poisonous.
Conflict within, conflict without. What can we say about these Florentines?
That they are human beings.
That is a good answer.
What they offered me was so much less than I had hoped. There was a price put on my return. I was under a sentence of death, and before that could be removed, I would have to undergo a ritual humiliation. When I returned, I would be briefly put into prison, and then required to put on sackcloth and ashes and walk through the streets of Florence to the church of John the Baptist, where I would offer him my unworthy soul and beg for mercy. Even if they were not lying to me and intended to burn me alive anyway, the price was too high. Was this the reward for 15 years of exile? I could manage on my own. I didn't need Florence. Other cities respected me. Other cities looked after me. Sometimes I was begging for bread and a roof over my head, but I did not have to accept the humiliation Florence offered.
So what place is there for you in all this, my great-great-grandson? That is what I have come down to consider with you. I represent the brave and the good. What should be your plan for the future while you are still alive?
Di sua bestialitate il suo processo farà la prova.
Their bestial stupidity will have its own reward. In the meantime, it will be better for your future fame to become a party of one.
A party of one? So I should continue to write my poem?
Their petty squabbles will be footnotes in history. Your poem will last forever.
And now we ascend again.
The sixth heaven.
It is ruled by Jupiter, and therefore...
Is the sphere belonging to the just.
Your head is full of your ancestors' parting advice.
Is that wrong? Am I being very conceited?
You are being yourself.
That's not a comfortable answer.
It is not intended to be.
The red glow of Mars turned pale, like a girl who blushes no longer, and we were in the silvery white sphere of the planet Jupiter. Here, the luminous souls of the just monarchs and governors wheeled like flocks of birds at dusk, forming lines and curves.
It's almost as if their movements are spelling out words.
Watch longer.
Yes. Diligite. Justitiam. Qui judicatis terram. Love justice, you who rule the world.
The lines and curves continued to shift shape, golden against the silver sky. And then seamlessly, there appeared first wings, and then the complete form of a golden eagle. And the eagle spoke to me. It was the embodiment of the thousands of souls which made up its shape, but it spoke with a single voice.
Love justice, you who rule the world. The just speak with one voice and one mind. There is no I and mine here, nor should there be when true justice is concerned. We must have always the general good in mind, and think of we and our, like coals which burn together to form one unified glow of heat. So the voice of the eagle is the voice of true justice.
The eagle is, of course, the Roman eagle, the symbol of empire. And as I sit here, I review my hopes for the future of Italy, for the future of Europe. To me, there still seems only one hope for the future. A holy Roman emperor to unite Europe under a just and benign rule. A latter-day Roman empire.
Love, justice, you who rule the world.
There's something I need to ask.
It is the question that's been worrying you since you began your journey.
It concerns Virgil, my poetic master. He was a good man. He was a great poet, and yet he is not allowed to accompany me here to Paradise.
Consider somebody born in a distant land where nobody has any knowledge of Christ. This person is sinless in word and deed, but will inevitably die unbaptized because he or she has no understanding of God's grace. This person will therefore be denied entry to Paradise and to the bliss of those close to God. You are questioning the justice of this.
I confess, I don't understand it. And now you tell me there are classical rulers here with you in the circle of Jupiter. I'm very sorry, but, well, to put it simply, it doesn't seem fair.
No one can fully understand the will of God. Not even us here. High up in the sphere of the just.
I wouldn't for a moment dare to question God's will.
The choices you refer to must indeed seem unfair or incomprehensible to mortal understanding. But this ruling comes from the will of God.
I know that.
And if it is the will of God, then it must be good. None of us can fully comprehend that. So who are you to question it?
Nobody. But then, do we have a will in all this? Or has God already made the decisions?
A voi, mortali, tenetevi stretti a giudicar, che noi, che Dio vedemo, non conosciamo ancor tutti gli eletti.
And you mortals, said the eagle, hold back from making judgments. For even we who see God do not yet know all the chosen or why they are chosen.
And then we were rising up into the seventh heaven, the sphere of Saturn.
You hardly ever smile.
But I am not a plaster Madonna fixed into a simpering devotional pose.
I idolize you, but I would never think that. There is a mind and a spirit to you beyond my words to express.
So why do you ask why I don't smile?
Maybe it's because if you smiled, you would fracture my senses into a thousand pieces. It is enough to be here, in your presence.
So what shall we find in the sphere of Saturn?
The contemplatives. The monastics. Those who devoted their lives to contemplating the mystery and the love of God.
And here they are.
There was silence. The silence of those who have sat alone in monastic cells, or on deserted islands, or in unpeopled forests, opening their minds to an understanding of God and his purpose.
I am St. Benedict. In the 5th century of our Lord, I fled from the corruption of Rome, so wrongly named the Holy City. Inspired by God, I built the monastery of Monte Cassino, high on a mountaintop, and I wrote rules to guide the monks who lived with me there. I had pondered these rules carefully and long under the guidance of God. They set out the principles of humility, obedience, worship, and service that have regulated the lives of monks ever since, whether they obey them or not, and many modern monks, of course, do not, but Enough of that. For our purposes, the most important fact is that I created guidelines for silent contemplation.
That is why it is silent here.
It is not silent.
I don't understand.
There is music here. But you are not yet spiritually strong enough to cope with its intensity. You must undergo a further process of purification before you are ready.
Forgive me. I bow to your will.
Not my will. The higher will.
Then, like a whirlwind, the shining lights all gathered upward, and my Lady Beatrice and I began to ascend a golden ladder towards the eighth heaven. Ruled by Gemini, my natal sign.
You are very close to the ultimate salvation. Your eyes should be able to see everything more clearly than ever before. And so, before we go on, look back down below.
I turned my eyes downwards through every one of the seven spheres through which we had passed, and there, way below, I saw the earthly globe, which seemed such a pitiful thing that I smiled. That so much conflict and so much pain and so much unhappiness could be within that tiny sphere. L'aiuola che ci fa tanto feroci.
The earth, that little threshing floor which makes men fierce and mad.
We were in the eighth circle, the circle of the fixed stars. The light, which before I thought was dazzling, was nothing to what I now experienced.
Ecco le schiere del trionfo di Cristo e tutto il frutto raccolto del girar di queste sfere.
Behold the hosts of Christ's triumph, the harvest gathered from the circling of the spheres. But keep your eyes steady. See who is approaching, outshining all the others. Here is Christ himself.
I'm so sorry.
You've been overcome by a power from which there is no escape.
I do not wish to escape, but my mind is bursting.
Look at me.
I feel lost, as if I've never existed.
Look at me.
No, it's too much.
Look at me.
And for the first time, I was able to look fully into my Lady Beatrice's eyes.
My lady.
You see my smile.
I had never expected to see it. It's beautiful.
We are close. But we are not yet there.
I'm sorry. My brain is still reeling.
You must undergo questioning.
I'm not sure I'm capable of answering questions.
You are. The answers will come from within you. They will come from everything you have learned in your long journey, through hell and purgatory and heaven.
You smile again. I am ready.
And here is your first examiner. Do not be frightened. He is here at my request to question you about your faith. You recognize him?
St. Peter.
The rock upon which the Christian faith is built. The simple fisherman who once at Christ's bidding walked upon water. The apostle who was crucified by the Romans upside down because he did not consider himself worthy enough to be crucified in the same way as our Lord. The first leader of the faith. The first pope. And oh, so much more worthy than those who have followed in his steps.
So tell me, traveler, what is faith?
I do not want to disappoint you by my answer.
If it's true, there will be no disappointment.
Then I must quote from someone far wiser and holier than I am. St. Paul said, faith is what gives substance to our hopes and makes us certain of realities we do not see. All the deep mysteries which I have been allowed to witness here are hidden from the eyes of those down below on earth. So they must learn to rely on faith to give substance to their hopes for the future.
That is a good answer. The coin you have produced passes all the tests regarding legal weight. But do you have that coin safely stowed in your own purse?
I'm on a quest, a search for meaning, and finding true meaning is never easy. Nor do I make it easy within my poem. But I do have real faith. I do have a powerful vision of what my life after death will be like. And to be honest, sometimes now I long for it, oh, so deeply.
And here is your second examiner, St. James.
Again, I can only hope to give a truthful answer.
My question concerns hope. Say what you think hope is, and how hope flourishes within your brain.
Blessed Father, the reason this man is here in Paradise, although he is still alive, is all about the power of his hope. Without hope, he could never have come this far.
This is true, but he must also answer for himself.
Then let me say that hope is a certain expectation of future glory. It is the product of divine grace and good works done before. Its light within me comes from many sources, but first of all, it came from King David, the singer of the Psalms, who wrote, "Let them hope in thee who know thy name." And I believe it is hope of heaven, not fear of hell, which should make mankind good.
This is a good answer.
And here comes your third questioner. It is St. John.
Faith and hope. So this must be about love.
Suddenly, everything went dark. I looked in vain to my Lady Beatrice for reassurance, but I could not see her. I had gone blind.
Do not look to see bodies. There are no bodies. Even here, the bodies are dust and await the final resurrection. All that is here is light.
And I cannot see it.
Concentrate upon what St. John has to say to you.
So, pilgrim, tell me about the meaning of love.
The love of God.
All other sorts of love lead to that, don't they?
That is why I'm here. That is what has inspired me to make this journey.
Why did I make myself go blind? Perhaps I knew I had to be vulnerable in order to answer the final questions. The deepest questions. The questions about love.
To know God is to love him. But to learn how to know God is a long and difficult journey. I was lost in a dark wood and I couldn't find a way out of it. I came close to killing myself. And it was love that led me into the light. Not perhaps always the right kind of love, but within it, a spark of the insight my love for the Lady Beatrice had given me. But the key was that I let go and followed love. But I felt bitterness and hatred against so many people. I felt revulsion against the darker impulses within my heart, and I had to go down into the depths to recognize and understand them. For love that cannot comprehend darkness is not true love. And then slowly I began to climb out of that darkness and to understand that there was hope and there was emotional growth, although it cannot be easily won.
and without love. The love of something beyond ourselves, that is not possible. Then I came to paradise, and I have been struck blind in order that I may see. I see that the world's existence and my own being, the death Christ bore for me that I might live, all that I have experienced and all that I have labored to understand have saved me from the sea of twisted love and brought me to the shore where love is good.
Faith and hope and love, you have learned to understand them all.
And the souls of the fixed stars began to sing, and my sight was restored to me. Ciò che io vedeva mi sembrava un riso dell'universo, perché mia ebbrezza entrava per l'udire e per lo viso. O gioia, o ineffabile allegrezza, o vita integra d'amore e di pace, o senza brama sicura ricchezza.
It seemed to me that I was finally seeing the smile of the universe. I was intoxicated not only with my hearing, but also with my sight. Oh, joy! Oh, indescribable happiness! Oh, life filled to the brim with joy and peace! Oh, riches freed from all longing!
And again, I could see Beatrice.
And now we can ascend to the final sphere, the primum mobile. The primum mobile is the source of all motion. The universe, which holds the center still and moves all around it, starts from here. Outside this final sphere, there is no space and no time. This is the end of the universe. Beyond this, there is only one thing.
God.
This final heaven is within the mind of God, whose love controls it and whose power filters down through it.
So everything is finally contained within God's mind.
Did you ever doubt it? And how it is regulated and how our lives happen come from God. We live within his mind. The universe is like a tree fed by God's love. There are multiple branches and countless leaves, but each leaf, every fragment of each leaf, contains a fragment of divine love.
So all the unhappiness and conflict in our lives
happens because human beings turn against the loving force which wants to give them nurture.
And the nourishing smile of God's universe is always there.
We are all leaves upon the tree. Even me.
But you're beyond all that.
In your mind, yes. Look down one last time.
I'm scared.
You should not be frightened anymore.
And I looked down, and I saw below me ever-moving points of light, forming and reforming patterns, each one representing a soul, and each one ever-moving upwards. Think of snow gently falling.
Think of a sky filled with snow lit from below. Your eyes play tricks upon you as you try to make sense of what you see. And then try to transfer that image to something which is rising rather than falling.
And as we rose, I looked up to my Lady Beatrice, because I was now strong enough to gaze upon her fully. And she seemed of such transcendent beauty that words even now fail me.
We are in the Empyrean. The heaven of pure light.
Again, I cannot see.
Be patient.
It is too much.
Wait. Trust. Now look again. See the blessed all assembled.
I had not expected ever to be able to see such sights, but my senses had been enhanced by all I had been through. I saw things in a new way. It was like the moment at the end of a masked ball when all the dancers finally remove their masks and the truth is revealed. The light of God striking upon the prima mobile below was reflected up upon the ranks of the truly blessed, to whom it gave the power to look upon God himself. It was to here that the glowing snowflakes, the pure souls of the blessed, had risen. Before me was an assembly filled with the souls of all who had ever achieved grace. They sat in a vast bowl lit by God's light, or perhaps it is more accurate to describe it as a white rose, a rose of such dimension that it could encompass the sphere of the sun, a rose giving off an exquisite scent of praise to the divine being. And around this immense rose flew the angels, like swarms of bees collecting nectar, ministering peace and ardor to them from God. For passion here is peaceful, and peace passionate.
Nothing I have seen before has prepared me for this. I am like a barbarian who sees Rome in all its glory for the first time. I, who live in the world, am witnessing divine splendor. I, who live in finite time, am now face to face with eternity. I am inspired by the sight of souls who are good and sane and just.
It is time for you to reach the goal of your desire. It is time for you to see that true vision of divine things, for which everything you have witnessed before has been preparing you.
Is the journey nearly over?
It is time for me to leave you. It is time for me to take my place among the blessed.
I know I must accept that. Thank you, my Lady Beatrice, for all you have shown me, and for bringing me out of the dark wood into this place of blessedness.
And thank you.
I don't understand.
I was a young aristocratic girl in Florence who died too soon. Would I be here? Would I be remembered if it was not for you?
I wanted to say more, but she was gone. Looking into the light. I have no more strength to resist it than a babe in arms. If I concentrate, I can make out three great interlocking circles. The first reflects the second like a rainbow reflecting upon another rainbow, and the third circle is like a flame breathed out by the other two. Within is an image of a man. Not superimposed, but an integral part. I am witnessing God. I am witnessing the Trinity.
I scrabble for words to describe this. I am Dante Alighieri. I was born in Florence in the year of our Lord 1265. And I am destined to die in Ravenna in 1321. To the end of my life, I longed for a return to Florence and for acceptance in my birthplace of who I was and what I had achieved. I made this poem out of my life and my aspirations. My wife and my sons are not in it. My first love is. To create a vision of life beyond life is an extraordinary and daunting undertaking.
I am being subsumed into paradise. I am one with the Trinity and the souls of the blessed. Finally, I am complete.
After this, all attempts of human imagination fail, because my will and my desire were turned like well-designed wheels towards the love which moves the sun and all the other stars.
All'alta fantasia qui manco possa, ma già volgeva il mio desio e il velle, siccome rotta ch'igualmente è mossa l'amor che muove il sole e l'altre stelle.
In the Divine Comedy, Paradiso, by Dante Alighieri, Dante the poet was played by Blake Ritson, the older Dante by John Hurt, and Beatrice by Hattie Morahan. The spirits in Paradise were Sam Dale, Steve Toussaint, Michael Burtonshaw, Carolyn Pickles, Priyanga Burford, Clive Hayward, Cassie Layton, and David Kahn. The Divine Comedy was dramatized by Stephen Wyatt, sound design was by Caleb Knightley, and the directors were Emma Harding and Mark Beebe.